grows on the water. And so, you know, part of that is that you're always, you know, grateful and you, you know, do your best to take care of your relatives, whether they have wings or fins or roots or paws. You know, I'm not sure what might cover, but like in our language, our king, that means land, but it means, doesn't mean like private property, it means like land to which the people belong. Land to which the people belong. And I like to think about that because, you know, the whole idea of ownership is kind of an unusual construct. You know, because I feel like that this land is so much bigger than us and our water is so much bigger than us, you know? And I often think of, there was a treaty, a lot of treaties or agreements between our people existed before the Europeans. Before the Europeans. So, for instance, there's a treaty signed in 1712. That's the date they estimate between the Haudenosaunee, that's the Six Nations, Iroquois people, and the Anishinaabe, that's us. And that treaty is called the One Dish, One Spoon Treaty. It's reflected in a wampum belt. Have you heard of the wampum belts, the Iroquois wampum belts? So there's a wampum belt, I'd like to see that belt, and it's called the One Dish, One Spoon Wampum. It's a treaty. And in that treaty, you know, our people, at that time, you know, we pretty much span the northern part of five American states and the southern part of four Canadian provinces. We're a large nation. And our to the east is our people, the Haudenosaunee, the Six Nations, and, you know, we would quarrel with them. Like, a lot of quarrels happen over stupid things. We all know that. No society has a monopoly on doing stupid stuff. You know, but, so we quarrel, and, so we signed this treaty, the One Dish, One Spoon, because we said, you know, we all have to hunt, we all hunt the same territory. We gather our berries in the same territory, we fish the same territory, so we have one dish. One dish. And then they said we also have one spoon, which is, you know, if you share a spoon in the ceremonies with someone else, then your relatives. Then your relatives. And so that's what that treaty is to work, is to care for the same, you know, that everybody should be respectful, take only what they need in their hunting and their fishing, and recognize we have one dish. And so I think about that treaty that our people signed in 1712, you know, with the Iroquois Confederacy, before we were signing treaties with the United States or France or England or, right? All those guys. And I think that that treaty is like a really profound thought as a treaty. You know, because today all of us, we all breathe out the same water, right? We all breathe the same air. We all, you know, are. We have the same microphone.
Treaty is agreement between them. governments, if you and I were going to do something, you wanted me to help you in your garden, we'd sign a contract. But when governments do it, those are called treaties. And that's why tribes today have this unique status in the United States. The treaties identified that they were a unique government. And there's basically three governments in the United States that have attributes of sovereignty. If you had a question on sovereignty. But the sovereigns in the United States are the United States itself, which is known as the Supreme Sovereign. Then there are state governments that have sovereignty, and they are called quasi-sovereigns because they derive their power from the United States. The United States gives some of its power to the state. Now, there are four states that are commonwealths, and there's a good trivia question which states are commonwealths, but anyway. And then there are tribal governments. Tribal governments do not derive their power from the United States. They have what's called inherent sovereignty. That's the ability of themselves to govern themselves. So that's kind of the relationships of governments in the United States. Essentially, the United States made treaties with Indian tribes from about 1790 through 1871. After 1871, the United States passed a law that it would not negotiate any further treaties with Indian tribes in the United States. And there's one main reason for that, because essentially they had all the land that tribes owned. And almost all of the treaties that were entered into by Indian tribes with the United States were to cede land to the United States. It's basically was a, if you own your house, you know what a deed, the title to your land is, because you have a deed to your house. Well, the treaties were deeds from one government to another saying you get to use this land. And what the United States did was it negotiated those and bought land. And you know of all kinds of situations about false treaties, breaking of treaties, broken treaties, all of those kinds of words. Unfairness of treaties, but they were essentially agreements that exchanged with Indian tribes land. And the land became something that today, all of this town, most of Minnesota, everybody has a title to a piece of tract of land. The basis for that were the treaties. And there's a map over on that second panel there down in the corner of the state of Minnesota. And if you look at that, you can see which treaty session your land is located in. And that treaty will tell you when the United States acquired that land from Indian tribes. And in exchange for that selling of that land, what the United States had as a policy, and this has changed over years, but initially in the 1850s and 40s, the United States started creating reservations, homelands for Indian people, and permanent homes for them, it was called. If you look at the early treaties of the Eastern Seaboard, you won't see reservations there, because at that time, the government's policy, once they bought land, was to remove Indian people, and they moved them west. By the 1840s and 50s, there was no place to move people west anymore because the west was being occupied from California across the Rockies, and so that all stopped, and they started creating reservations. And then the reservations were to become permanent homelands for Indian people. And Indian leaders, in many cases, were involved in that whole establishment. I think on that map there, on that panel there, it shows the different locations of reservations in Minnesota. And the Chippewas of Mississippi, there were six of those at that time, and they met in Washington, D.C. in 1855. to New York and then down to Washington, D.C. to negotiate treaties. And they were actually shown a map and asked to locate where they lived and to describe where they wanted their reservation. So that's why a lot of those reservations are located where they are today, is because that was agreed to in 1855. And in exchange for that was a large tract of land that the United States government got to use and open up for settlement, is what it was called. One of the things people ask is, why would Indian people agree to that? Why would you do that? And there's a number of reasons that happened. The Cherokee, for example, in the 1830s said, no, we're not moving out of Georgia. You know what happened? They got moved out of Georgia. And it's called the Trail of Tears. And they got moved to Oklahoma. Tribes knew that. They knew that ultimately the United States could force them to do it. So that was one reason. Another reason was that the United States said, look at what we've built here. They showed them the Capitol, they showed them the White House, they showed them the Navy, they showed them the Army, and they said, see what we've done with the land? We've brought all these people to live on it, then we take a little bit of money from each one of us and we can build all this stuff. We'll take a little bit more and we'll give that to you and help you build your company and your businesses and your government, and so your children will be prosperous. But if you look at comments and letters that tribal leaders sent back to Washington after the treaties, they said, when do our children start to prosper? But we don't see that happening. Where is that money that was supposed to flow over to us? Some of that still is happening. It's called trust responsibility. The United States government has a trust obligation to Indian tribes. And as Mike was saying, it provides things like originally blacksmiths, education, those types of things. And today it's much broader. Provides some medical services, some economic development. It's certainly not enough for most tribes. Casinos, some people think that's the answer for a lot of things. It helps. Some tribes, because of location, are very successful with their casinos. Others are not quite so successful. But it depends on location and that type of thing. So those are all things, but those are all generated out of this agreement to acquire the land. And that's where the treaties came from. Then if you look at individual treaties, you'll see certain types of conditions that tribes wanted to have included. Initially, tribes just wanted to lease the land to the United States, like for 25 years. And the United States negotiators said, no, we don't lease. We want to own it. And so then there were provisions like the right to hunt, fish, and gather. And that was a treaty that I worked on, an 1837 treaty that said the Ojibwe or the Chippewa reserved the right to hunt, fish, and gather wild rice on all lands and waters hereby ceded during the pleasure of the president. And those few words took about, I think, 18 years of my life to get that interpreted, what that meant. And it was a really interesting undertaking because you got to be involved with a lot of different things. And you got to meet congressmen, and you got to meet enforcement officers, and you got to meet sports groups, and you got to meet anti-treaty groups that were very bigoted and racist. And you got to deal with all of it and talk with them about this. A lot of times what you'll hear is that those are old things. They don't mean anything, those treaties. People will say that. But they're really the foundation for why all of these people can have land here, why all these buildings. don't say, oh, I'm going to give my deed away to my house. I don't need that. I'll just say it's mine. You know, there's elaborate systems to protect people's ownership and that. And that's what treaties did, was a fundamental basis for that. You can't just throw that away. And in particular, you can't throw away if there are other provisions, like the right to hunt, fish, and gather. And that's what in 1999 the Supreme Court said, that the Ojibwe reserved that right to hunt, fish, and gather. And hence it's been implemented. And it's basically the right to gather where public hunting is allowed. And so many people worry about if tribal people get the right to hunt and fish. We used to kind of laugh about it, that your canary that's sitting in your house or your parakeet will be open game for tribal people. That's not what the right says. It's not a right like that. It's a right to a hunt or fish where public hunting and fishing is allowed. So it's only in those areas. It's not on private land, and it's not private resources. It's only where public is allowed to hunt that tribal members can also hunt on that, independent of state licensing requirements. So that's, and that goes back to this inherent tribal sovereignty, quasi-state sovereignty, two separate governments, separate rules about how that can happen and how that can be implemented. So those are the types of things that are associated with those relationships and why that exists. Yes.
So was it last week that the Supreme Court issued that decision on the Crow case?
Yes. Last week there was a Ferrara versus Wyoming case. It's went through the Supreme Court. Ferrara was a Crow member, a member of the Crow tribe. He had left the reservation and hunted an elk in the Bighorn Mountains in Wyoming. He shot an elk, took it home. He was later cited by the state of Wyoming for not having a state license. And that moved through the court system, and last week the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that Ferrara had a right to hunt off reservation under tribal authority. And so it's very similar to the Mille Lacs case. In fact, the Supreme Court justices used the Mille Lacs case as the basis for why that right still existed in Wyoming for the Crow tribe. It was a different treaty, but it still had hunting and fishing, ability to hunt, fish, and gather in there. And so the Supreme Court upheld that based upon the last court decision. So those things are ongoing. There are issues that are heavily involved. Sometimes they create a lot of publicity, I would say, and it's something that needs to be understood. And one of our real problems is that when we all went to school, nobody talked about treaties. We didn't, in our civics class, we never had one discussion about that there are tribal governments and the ability of tribal governments to regulate things related to tribal affairs. Just a quick kind of summary, tribal governments, they went from when they were, the United States was first created, tribes were looked at as brothers, our red brothers. If you read early history, George Washington, most types of people talk about people as our red brother. By about 1850, Indian people are referred to as our red children. And that philosophy is still out there, that the United States government is the war for Indian people. Indian people are our children. And then they went through a period of assimilation. We're going to make Indian people like everybody else. We're going to take away their tribalism. We're going to take all their land and divide it up and give them each a piece of land. They're called allotments. And try to individual United States was supposed to keep track of those allotments and didn't. And as some know about White Earth and the Land Settlement Act, that White Earth, all the problems that arose out of that from the government failure to keep track of that. So that's a whole nother issue. Then after it became assimilation, then there was, in the 1970s, there was something called self-determination. The tribes were supposed to be self-determined as to what they wanted to do. And then in 1987, there was a law passed called self-governance. And that is the latest policy of Indian tribes, is that they are self-governing. And it strengthens the idea of tribal sovereignty and the ability of tribes to move forward. If you're interested in all that, there's something called House Concurrent Resolution 331 that was passed in 1987 that talks about Indian tribes' contribution to the United States Constitution. And that the United States Constitution was based upon tribal forms of government more than it was some kind of structure that just came from Benjamin Franklin and different people that wrote with Thomas Jefferson. They actually studied Indian tribal governments, particularly the Iroquois Confederacy, because they knew it was a very powerful structure of governance, and that was implemented. If you're interested in reading more about that, read Bartholomew de la Costa. He was a missionary in the 1500s. Who studied tribal governments and wrote tremendous amounts about democracy that tribal governments had. So there's a huge reference there. For, yes?
I think I'm aware that there's a difference between the sovereignty of the Red Nation and other tribes, but can you explain?
Yes. Remember I said that tribes, that the United States government stopped making treaties in 1871. And if you look at Red Lake map up there, and then if you look at that map over there, there's a 63 session, but there's an 1889 session under the Nelson Act. That land wasn't ceded to the United States until 1889. After the treaties were done being made. So there's a large section of land up by Red Lake that was never ceded to the United States government until 1889. Under that, the Red Lake land, where the Red Lake Reservation is today, that was never ceded to the United States government. The United States never signed a treaty that said all of this land up here will be ours and then we'll give some back. That didn't happen. They took the land away from around Red Lake Reservation, but they never took the land under Red Lake Reservation. So the United States government has never held title to that land, so people who are interested in land titles and stuff. And it's called a closed reservation. There's one other reservation in Idaho that's closed. Has a similar status, but Red Lake's land has never been owned by the United States government and hence has a different status.
I just kind of like what you're saying there. Red Lake would not accept in 1934 the End of Reorganization Act and the form of government that all the other tribes have. They have a chairman and secretary treasurer and three representatives, and they're forming an IRA government base. Red Lake did not accept it. They wanted to keep their own traditional form of government, of the tribal council. And the other reservation was the Wedll, who did not accept that. That act in 1934. Because of that, also, that's the reason why we consider it's considered closed because of the ownership is strictly Red Lake, not
selling of land that was held by natives to, is that?
That's Melissa Meyer's book. She's at the, I don't know if she's still at the University of Minnesota, but it's basically, you know, what happened at Wired was really wrong. You know, because Wired was the reservation that we were told that we could have forever, and we got, so we get pretty good territory. You know, 36 miles by 36 miles, 837,000 acres. Medicine Chest of the Ojibways, 47 lakes, 500 bodies of water. Not bad days, right? You know, plus the buffalo, you know, and that, you know, that what we had understood. And so, you know, that land is also, you know, I have this theory, the better land you have, the less of it you have today. So just look at the Wampanoags on Martha's Vineyard, how are they doing? You know what I'm saying? The Native Hawaiians, how are they doing? You understand what I'm saying? Like, you know, if you got like really great land, then someone could try to steal it. So Frederick Weyerhaeuser, Little Falls, huge amount of timber came off our reservation, basically built a lot of Minneapolis. Built, was it the Congdon? Congdon, the big Congdon mansion, all that's from Weyer. You know, and so they cast their eyes upon the reservation. They got, you know, the Steenerson and the Clapp Act passed, which would, you know, enable them to both cut trees, and then in the allotment period, you know, people were thumbprinting deeds. You know, a lot of our land was stolen illegally, most of it. So today about 10% of the reservation is still held by our tribe. A third of it is held by the federal, state, and county governments. You know, my position has always been, like, I raised this, my grandkids, but, you know, granddaughter, but I raised a lot of kids, and I always tell them, don't steal, right? You know, but Becker County, Clearwater County, Monoman County, and the federal government took a lot of our land, Tamarack Refuge. 224,000 acres of the White Earth Reservation is held by government agencies. And so that whole process dispossessed us. People left, you know, a lot of Mike's relatives, you know, over in Pine Point, then epidemics swept through. Killed a lot of people, a lot of people ended up over there in Aguaching. You know what I'm talking about? There was the former sanitarium over there by Walker. About a quarter of white people tried to go through there. A lot of us perished, and by the 1930s, most of us lived in the Twin Cities, forced off, we were refugees. You know, our land was all taken for timber, all taken, and you know, so that's the tragedy of Wedll. That's the story.
So, a follow-up question then, the land reclamation project?
Wedll is every project that I've, yeah.
Yeah, so when did that start, and what changes have occurred as a result of that, mm-hmm. in terms of owning
You know, in the late 1970s, they started something called the, it came out of the Claims Act. And they started reviewing land on 2415 claims nationally, because what happened on White Earth was kind of a microcosm of what happened nationally. Don was talking about that they didn't keep track of things, basically theft, bad guys, you know, everything. Happened to us. And Park Rapids was pretty complicit, frankly. You know, Park Rapids benefited heavily from that, from the dispossession of the Ojibwe. And so, you know, they began to do this national investigation called the 2415 investigation, which was a national investigation. White Earth was one of the tribes. And in that, you know, lo and behold, we find out that most of that land was taken away. Right? Some of you remember this story. You kind of remember this story? And so then, you know, I was young when I could, you know, come back here and what we knew, you know, I know that Bob, he just kind of shimmied, but, you know, also Mike, you know, we knew our land had been taken illegally, so the government then began was trying to address it, right? And their proposals were not very good. They were doing this investigation under Bush 1, right? Bush 1, y'all follow me about this time period? That investigation was never completed. So we didn't ever get the full benefit of the investigation of all of the title problems, right? And what then Stanglin, do you remember Congressman Stanglin, any of you? Arlen Stanglin, he was a long-term guy, and he said, you know, we're not going to return any land to you. What we're going to do is we're going to pay you. And so we're going to pay you $3 million for the 700,000 acres of land that we, you know, that transferred, you know, to us. And we're just going to do this. And we said no. You know, so I was one of the young people, you know, a lot of us had organized and opposed that. We said, you know, you can't pay us 1910 market value for land you're stealing in 1985. You you know, this is not 1910. We're not third class citizens anymore. And my position still remains that the only compensation for land is land. That is to say, return the public lands, you know, inside the reservation. But, you know, so we worked hard, you know, and it went from 3 million to 20 million. You know, that's what the settlement was, but we opposed the settlement. And the settlement was passed in Congress with the, what was it called, suspension of the rules. There was like 52 members totally present in all of Congress, or less than that. And they got that law through, and then we sued.